So this video may be a rather more abstract video than the ones that precede it. It looks at Freud's keystone paper from 1915, entitled The Unconscious, one of the metapsychological papers, and also a paper delivered by Jean Laplanche, and Serge Leclerc at a conference in 1960 in Bonneval, southwest of Paris. And this paper of Laplanche and Leclerc is also called The Unconscious. In fact, their paper is called The Unconscious, a Study. And this video, I have to warn you, also contains mathemes, these quasi-mathematical formulae that are so beloved of Lacan and of Lacanians. And in fact, Lacan himself was at the Bonneval conference that Laplanche and Leclerc delivered their paper to. And he responded formally to their paper in an écrit called Position of the Unconscious, which you can find in the volume of Lacan's écrit. This one was written up in 1964, so 4 years after the conference itself, and it very much bears the traces of Lacan's 11th seminar, which was also given that year, the seminar on the four fundamental concepts. Laplanche and Leclerc themselves, of course, were Lacan's, certainly his pupils. I think they were both analysands of Lacan as well. And he describes their presentation at the Bonneval conference as a moment of combat in a place where ideas were exchanged. Anyway, the mathemes in this video are actually Laplanche's, and they seem unusually valuable to me. So that's why I've included them. So, Laplanche and Leclerc's paper is a reading, really, of Freud's paper. And Laplanche, in particular, locates two impasses within Freud's paper on the unconscious. The first is that Freud presents two hypotheses about how conscious and unconscious psychic content may be stored, so to speak. And roughly speaking, the first hypothesis states that a memory is stored in one of two psychical realms, depending on whether it's conscious, or at least susceptible to being conscious, or whether it's unconscious. So in other words, a memory is stored in the unconscious if it's been repressed, but it may transfer over to the preconscious or the conscious realm if it becomes de-repressed. The second hypothesis, however, states that the same memory may be in both realms simultaneously. So not that it might move from one to the other, but that it's in both at the same time. And Freud's theory of repression suggests that the first hypothesis, which he calls the functional hypothesis, the one where the psychic content can move from the unconscious to the conscious, but it can't be in both at the same time, repression suggests that that's a better hypothesis. But that first hypothesis would also imply that if the analyst and the patient can work together in a way where a repressed, unconscious piece of data can be made conscious, it would suggest that the patient's symptoms will disappear. And Freud knew that often that doesn't happen. So, in the 1915 paper, Freud, perhaps he hedges his bets, and he goes with both hypotheses. Even though they're incompatible with each other, he decides to go with both. The second impasse in Freud's paper that Laplanche picks up on is the distinction between Wortvorstellungen, word presentations, and Sachvorstellungen, thing presentations. The thing presentation is largely visual, whereas the word presentation is largely heard or spoken. If we go back to Freud's paper, The Unconscious, he writes, "The conscious presentation comprises the presentation of the thing plus the presentation of the word belonging to it, while the unconscious presentation is the presentation of the thing alone." So assuming that psychoanalysis is about making something that is unconscious conscious, how might we go about joining up these thing presentations with their appropriate word presentations, particularly if the word never quite fits the thing? So to resolve this question, Laplanche introduces what he calls the representation chose, the thing-like representation. He introduces that as an alternative translation for Sachvorstellungen. And in doing so, he wishes to do away with any idea that the unconscious, or that in the unconscious, a signifier might refer to an object. The unconscious signifier, he says, can only refer to itself, not to any signified. It signifies to the subject, even if what it signifies has been lost. We could call it, as Laplanche does, a de-signified signifier. It's enigmatic. It may not be a word, it may be a gesture. But whilst I don't know what it conveys, I do know that it's conveying something to me. And these thing-like representations are, says Laplanche, what the child fails to translate into its working model of the interhuman world. Enigmatic signifiers which escape this translation process. And we should note again, as we did in the last video, that these signifiers are not just enigmatic to the child, they're also enigmatic to the adult who transmits them. So how does this translation project that the child embarks on, how does it work? Well, translation always works by substituting one signifier for another. And in this case, the child substitutes a new signifier, S2, for the enigmatic signifier, S1, which is to be translated. We'll see how these map onto each other in the math theme shortly. So this new signifier, S2, will bear some resemblance, or perhaps even strike up some opposition with S1, so that however obscurely, they're related. So this is Laplanche's schema. Now note how the original signifier on the left, the S1 over little s, is multiplied by the substitute signifier, S2 over S1. And what we end up with on the right-hand side is a new signifier, S2 over the original signified S, and underneath the bar, S1 over S1, which Laplanche describes as a residue of translation which no longer signifies anything other than itself. But, says Laplanche, this formula, particularly with its sharp equals sign towards the end, towards the right-hand side, this only works in mathematics. And if you're given to doing these sorts of things, if you try exchanging these values for numbers, you'll find that this does work as a mathematical equation. But Laplanche says it fairly obviously does not hold for psychical processes. So he rewrites it like this. This time we have a message to be translated, M1, instead of a signifier. For after all, one never translates a single signifier. And over towards the right, instead of an equal sign, we now have an arrow denoting a transformation. And to the right of the arrow, we now have a partial translation of the message, which is the M2 over the signified. And underneath that, we have a repressed signifier, S1 over S1. And this, says Laplanche, is something like the formula for primal repression. And it shows us that in this primary event, something is translated and something is repressed. And in the second part of this video, we'll apply this formula to an example, which is the example that Laplanche cites in another of his essays, the famous childhood memory of Leonardo da Vinci.